Hello everyone. Today we are going to deal with a new chapter from the book First Flight. The name of the chapter is From the Diary of Anne Frank, written by Anne Frank. Before going to the chapter, let's see who was Anne Frank. Anne Frank was born on 12th June 1929 and died in the year 1945. She was actually a German-born Jewish girl. She wrote a diary while hiding with her family and four friends in Amsterdam during the German occupation of the Netherlands in the Second World War. As the Nazis came to power in Germany, she along with her family moved to Amsterdam but got trapped when the Nazis occupied Netherlands. The Jewish population was being persecuted, and so the family went into hiding. In July 1942, in Otto Frank's office building, that is, the name of the building was the Secret Annex. Now you might be wondering, who was Otto Frank? Otto Frank was Anne's father. After 2 years in hiding, the group was betrayed and they were shifted to a concentration camp where Anne died within the days of her sister's death. Her sister's name was Margaret Frank. The father, Otto, was the only survivor after the Second World War. After the war ended, Anne's father returned to Amsterdam and found her diary, which was actually a unique record. He got it published under the name The Diary of a Young Girl. The diary actually was a gift to Anne on her 13th birthday, and it gives a detailed account of her life from 12th June 1942 until the final entry on 1st August 1944. The diary was originally written in Dutch language and it became one of the world's most widely read books. Many films, television and theatrical productions and an opera have been based on the diary. Anne's entry in the diary is described as the work of a mature and insightful mind. Insightful means one who has perspective. It provides an intimate examination of daily life under the Nazi occupation. Anne Frank has become one of the most famous and talked about Holocaust victims. Holocaust means destruction or slaughter on a mass scale. And this part of the story which we are going to do is actually an excerpt taken from the book written by Anne, which is known as The Diary of Anne Frank. Now, we'll start with the chapter. Writing in a diary is a really strange experience for someone like me. So, me here refers to whom? So, who is writing this? Yeah, Anne Frank. So, she's saying that writing is actually a strange experience. What do you mean by strange experience? Of course, strange means unusual. So, Anne Frank says that writing is actually a strange experience for her. Not only because I have never written anything before, but also because it seems to me that later on, neither I nor anyone else will be interested in the musings of a 13-year-old schoolgirl. So here what Anne means is that she is going to write a diary, but at the same point, she wants to clear one thing, that even though she's going to write the diary, she is of the opinion that neither she nor anyone would be interested in the future to see the musings. Musings means thoughts. What do you mean by musings? Thoughts. Thoughts of a 13-year-old schoolgirl. Of course, we always consider school children as very simple. We don't take their opinions or ideas very seriously, isn't it? So that's what Anne also says, that she won't be, or not only she, neither she nor anybody else will be interested to take things seriously. Which are those things? the thoughts which she is going to write in a diary. Of course, what do you write in a diary? We write all our feelings, our thoughts, or whatever we have, any experiences, we used to present it in the diary. So she's saying about that. Coming to the next line, oh well, it doesn't matter. Then at the same time she's saying, it doesn't matter, even though nobody is going to read or nobody is going to be interested in my writing, I don't mind it. Why? Because it doesn't matter. I feel like writing and I have an even greater need to get all kinds of things off my chest. So she says that, I feel like writing. Why she says that she feels like writing? Because she says that when I write, I will be able to put everything, the thoughts or feelings or whatever she has in her heart, she could put it out of her mind into the book in the written form. So that's what. So what do you mean by to get all kinds of things off my chest? It means to express something that has been worrying you. So many things are there that worries you and you're not able to share it with anybody. So what will you do? So if you have the habit of writing, then you can write everything in the diary. So that's what, to get all kinds of things off my chest. Off my chest means from her chest. Now, coming to the next line. Paper has more patience than people. It's actually a quote, isn't it? See, it's given in the inverted commas. So what she says that paper has more patience than people. Paper, you know, it's a non-living thing and you use it to write anything. Sometimes you scribble, sometimes you cut, sometimes when you cut and tear off. So whatever you want, you can do with it. But do you think you can do the same thing with the people? No. So that's why Anne Frank says, paper has more patience than people. It only means paper is more patient than the people. I thought of this saying on one of those days when I was feeling a little depressed and was sitting at home with my chin in my hands. So this sentence, this thought came to her mind when? During that time when she was sitting at home alone, very depressed. Depressed, sad, you know, we have a lot of mood swings, isn't it? So some time of the day we are very happy and at the end of the day you might be very sad. So it just happens that you might feel very depressed. So one such day when she was feeling a little bit depressed and sitting at home with my chin in my hands means sitting like this, isn't it? Bored and listless. What do you mean by listless? Listless means something in which you are not interested or maybe lack of enthusiasm. So some days are like that. We feel very lazy and we are not able to do anything. We don't feel any interest in anything. Wondering whether to sit, whether to stay in or go out. So as I said, some days are very lazy days and we feel very lazy and we are lacking enthusiasm. So same like that, Anne was also feeling in that way and she was thinking whether to stay in or go out. I finally stayed where I was. So she just remained there where she was, brooding means thinking seriously. Yes, paper does have more patience. And then she realized, yes, paper has more patience. She decided to that she can write anything in the diary without any fail because paper is more patient than the people. People, you know, they are of very they have different moods, isn't it? So they sometimes they might be very interesting or they might be very curious listener, but sometimes they go impatient when you start speaking. So but paper doesn't have any such problem. And since I'm not planning to let anyone else read the stiff back notebook. So she says that she is planning, she has a plan while she starts writing this diary. So what is that plan? She says that I'm not letting anyone else, she's not going to let anyone else read the book. Of course, we consider diary as a personal property and we don't allow to read it. So if you have any habit of writing the diary, you might be knowing how carefully you keep the book, isn't it? So same way here, we can see Anne says that she's clearly making, she's making it clear that she's not going to allow anyone to read her diary. So instead, so this is not referring the book diary as it is. Instead, she calls it as stiff back notebook. Stiff back means hard covered notebook. Hard covered notebook. Grandly. Grandly means beautifully. Beautifully referred to as a diary. So she is explaining the term diary very beautifully. What does she call? She calls it as stiff back notebook, which looks beautifully, and it is called the diary. And she plans to write this. As I told you, she's not going to allow anyone to read the book, and she's going to start the writing the diary when, unless I should ever find a real friend. That means she will write the diary and she will not show it to anyone. And she will continue writing this diary until she find a real friend. Why she specifies real friend? You know, we all have friends. And when we feel sad, we share all the happy things, sad things, whatever. We share it with our friends, isn't it? So Anne doesn't have one such friend, one such real friend. So she says that I'm going to write the diary till I'm going to find a real friend. It probably won't make a bit of difference. So till that time, that maybe it might not make any difference. Till that time, I will write the diary. So she's badly in need of a true friend, a real friend. Now, I'm back to the point that prompted me to keep a diary in the first place. Now, she's coming back to the point why she decided to keep a diary. Prompted means encouraged. Encouraged me to keep a diary. What encouraged her or what made her to take a decision that she is going to start writing a diary? Now, I'm back to the point that prompted me to keep a diary, as I told you. So, what encouraged her to write a diary? Why and what was the reason? She's making it very clear. I don't have a friend. So, I told you, we all need friends, isn't it? So, Anne didn't have a friend. And she's going to consider her diary as a friend. Let me put it more clearly. So now she is making it clear what made her to decide to write the diary. Since no one will believe that a 13-year-old girl is completely alone in the world. See the point? No one is going to believe that a 13-year-old is completely alone in the world. Will I think the same way that someone in your among you will be alone or feeling loneliness? No, you all come from a family, and having family members in your house, parents, aunties, uncles, cousins. So how can you think that you are alone? So same feeling was there with Anne. No one is going to believe that a 13-year-old girl is completely alone in the world. So you know, 30 teenagers usually have that feeling that they are alone in this world. A lonely feeling is there. And I am not. She is accepting the fact that she is not alone. I have loving parents. 30 people I can, loving parents, the 16-year-old sister, and there are about 30 people I can call friends. So she is saying the fact, she is revealing the fact that she is not alone. She has a family, a family with loving parents, a 16-year-old sister. She is having an elder sister. And along with that, she has 30 people whom she can call friends. And I have a family. She calls this as a family. So when we have a family, how can we think that we are alone? Loving aunts and a good home. Not only that, she has a family. She also have loving aunts and a good home. She's coming from a good home where no problems are there. So then how can a person feel lonely? No, on the surface, I seem to have everything. From outer, if outward look or out appearance, you can see that I have everything. But inside, what do I feel? I feel that I am alone, except my one true friend. Everything I have, nothing is there which I'm lacking, except one true friend. All I think about when I'm with friends is having a good time. So she's having friends, she's also hanging out. Of course, you also hang out with your friends, isn't it? So what do? You have fun time with them, you talk to them, you share, you enjoy, you laugh among with them, and you do different things, isn't it? The same thing Anne was also doing like that. But what happened? What was lacking? The real relationship between the friends. I can't bring myself to talk about anything but ordinary everyday things. So what was the problem? She didn't have anyone or any such friend with whom she can talk everything. That means even ordinary things that is happening in her life, each and everything with whom she can share. She didn't have that. We don't seem to be able to get any closer. Get any closer with whom? With the friends. The friends which she had, she didn't have that rapport with them. Might be she would have been an introvert. Opening up problem might have been there. So that's what she says. She was not able to get any closer. And that's the problem. Of course, when you're not able to get closer with your friends, you are finding difficult in approaching them, then definitely you will be having the same feeling. Maybe it's my fault that we don't confide in each other. So she says that maybe I'm not having a true friend because I might not be able to confide. Confide means trust. So the first thing what you need is trust, isn't it? So when you have trust in another person, definitely you will be feeling that freedom to share whatever feelings you have with your friend. And in any case, that's just how things are. And unfortunately, they're not liable to change. So she is accepting the fact that she's not able to confide in each other. That means among the friends, the whoever or whichever friend she has, she's not able to trust any one of them so that she can share her feelings. And she's accepting the fact that this is not going to change. Unfortunately, they are not liable to change. Nobody is going to change. Neither she nor her friends is going to change. This is why I have started the diary. And now it came, the point came up. What? That this is how I decided to write a diary. To enhance the image of this long awaited friend in my imagination. So we have seen that she didn't have many friends, isn't it? So she says that I was waiting long for one such friend in her imagination. And I didn't want to jot down the facts in this diary the way most people would do. So of course, when you start writing a diary, what you will do? You will just start writing the feelings, whatever, anything, whatever you feel in your mind, you will start writing it in the diary. But here she says that she's not going to jot down in the same way. She is making it unique. She's going to make it unique. She's going to start writing the diary in a unique way. But I want the diary to be my friend. Why she's feeling like that? She's feeling like that because she wants her diary to be something unique. So she says that she is going to consider my diary as my friend. And that's why she named it as Kitty. So what is she calling her? What is she referring her diary as? She's calling it as Kitty. Since no one would understand a word of my stories to Kitty if I were to plunge right in, I had better provide a brief sketch of my life, much as I dislike doing so. Since no one would understand, just imagine you are simply writing it in the diary, in nothing, just your feelings and everything. And one fine morning, somebody gets your diary and they try to read it. Will they get any information about the diary or whose is it? Or maybe who wrote it, they might come to know. But the details, I don't think it might be there in the diary, isn't it? So she says that, since no one would understand a word of my stories to Kitty. So Kitty is the name of the diary. So she refers her diary as Kitty. Since no one would understand a word of my story, so once they start reading the stories written in my diary, if they are not going to understand, then no point in it. It won't be any use. If I were to plunge right in, if I were to plunge means getting into it, right? Just from nowhere, she's getting into the diary by writing the details or about her feelings or maybe thoughts. I had better provide a brief sketch of my life. So, in order to get an idea about me, who I am, or what about why I'm writing this diary. So, everything, if you need to know, I think I should write or provide a brief sketch of my life. Brief sketch of my life means introduction about me and my family. And she also reveals the fact that she dislikes doing so. She was not in favor of doing such things. But still, in order to know who she was, it's better to give a brief sketch of her life. Brief sketch, introduction. Now she's starting with her family. My father, the most adorable father I have seen, didn't marry my mother until he was 36 and she was 25. So she loved her father very much. So she's calling her father as adorable father. Adorable means lovable. Lovable father I have ever seen. Of course, for all the children, especially the girls. Girls are daddy's girl, isn't it? So they all love their fathers very much and they have very high opinion about their father. So here Anne Frank also loved her father very much. So she calls him as adorable father. And she reveals the fact that her father didn't marry her mother, that means didn't marry my mother until he was 36. So he was 36 years when he married his when he married her mother. And what was her age? Her mother was only 25. My sister, Margaret, was born in Frankfurt in Germany in 1926. So, she had an elder sister, her name was Margaret, and she was born in Frankfurt. Frankfurt is in Germany. When was she born? She was born in the year 1926. I was born on 12 June 1929. So, how older was her sister? 3 years older. So she was born on 12th June 1929 and her sister was born in the year 1926. I was born on June 29. I lived in Frankfurt until I was 4. So she was 4 years old and till that time they lived in Frankfurt. My father emigrated to Holland in 1933. My father emigrated. Emigrated means to leave their homeland and to move into some other country to settle down there. So her father emigrated to Holland, went to some other country went to Holland to settle there in 1933. My mother, Edith Hollander Frank, went with him to Holland in September while Margaret and I were sent to Aachen to stay with our grandmother. So she was when her mother joined her father, they were sent to Aachen. Aachen is a place in Germany and where their grandmother stayed. Margaret went to Holland in December and I followed in February. So Margaret was also taken to Holland in December. And when did Anne follow? She followed in February when I was plunked down on the table as a birthday present for Margaret. So plunked means thrown. Here it means thrown. It's casually used, the term is casually used as thrown. Actually it means that Margaret was in Holland and Anne was taken or Anne was given to Margaret as her birthday present. So that's what it is casually used as plunked. Plunked means thrown. I started right away at the Montessori nursery school. So she started her schooling in the Montessori nursery And where I stayed there until I was six. Until I was six means 6 years old. She stayed there in that same school till she was 6 years old. At which time I started in the first form. First form means first standard. So she started her first standard class when she was six and she stayed there. In the sixth form, my teacher was Mrs. Cuperus, the headmistress. In the sixth form means sixth standard. My teacher was Mrs. Cuperus, the headmistress. The headmistress means the head of the teachers. So the head of the teacher or the headmistress was her teacher or class, we can say it as class teacher. Her name was Mrs. Cuperus. At the end of the year, we were both in tears as we said a heartbreaking farewell. So she remained in that school till her sixth standard. And at the end of the year, they had to say goodbye, a heartbreaking farewell, goodbye. She had to say with her, or she has to tell that to her teacher, which was very heartbreaking. And it came to know that from this, we can understand one thing, that is she had a good rapport with her teacher. So that's why pain taking goodbye means it's really difficult if you are really attached to a person, isn't it? So from this we can understand she had a good bond with her teacher. In the summer of 1941, grandma fell ill and had to have an operation. So my birthday passed with little celebration. So what happened? Her grandmother in 1941, her grandmother fell ill. That was a summer time and her grandmother fell ill. And not only that, she had to undergo an operation. And during that time, her birthday was in June, isn't it? And that time, her grandmother was ill. And what happened? Her birthday was not celebrated. It just went off silently. Grandma died in January 1942. Next year, January 1942, her grandmother died, and no one knows how often I think of her and still love her. She loved her grandmother very much, and that fact nobody knew it. So she says that nobody knows that I love her, still I love her. That fact is unaware what that she still love her grandmother. This birthday celebration in 1942 was intended to make up for the other. So last year, since grandmother was not ill, they couldn't celebrate her birthday, isn't it? So in order to compensate that, this year they had planned to celebrate it. And she decided to light a candle. Grandma's candle was lit along with the rest. So she decided to light a candle for grandma's sake, along with other candles. The four of us are still doing well. Now coming back to the present time, so she is jotting down all these things in her diary, isn't it? So after jotting down all these things, she's coming back to the present. And now she says, the four of us, that means her father, mother, her sister and herself, are all still doing well. And that brings me to the present date. That means she is coming back to the present date. So what is the date? 20 June 1942. So from this, one thing is clear, that she started to write the diary when? On 20 June 1942. And the solemn dedication of my diary. Solemn, she is dedicating. She has dedicated all these details into her diary. Solemn means sacred. Dedication with devotion. She's devoting all these things into her diary and has come back to the present date, that is 20 June 1942. So she started writing her diary when? On 20th June 1942, and that was a Saturday. So she is referring her diary as Kitty. She starts her diary, "Dearest Kitty." So she's writing. Usually we write the diary when at the end of the day, isn't it? We write all our experiences, whatever happened on that particular day, the events of that day, everything in the diary, isn't it? So she's sitting and has started to write the diary. She's referring the diary as what? "Dearest Kitty. Our entire class is quaking in its boots." Quaking in its boots means trembling. So now you might be wondering why they are trembling inside the class, isn't it? We will see the reason. The reason, of course, is the forthcoming meeting in which the teachers decide who will move up to the next form and who will be kept back. So now you might have got why they were trembling, isn't it? We all, of course, you, not me, you all, especially the children, students, after the exam, the day when the result is published, that particular day, you know how the feeling is, isn't it? So you might be wondering how many subjects you might have passed, how many subjects you have failed, or whether you will pass in all subjects or there will be a retest. I know you might be worrying about the retest rather than the result, isn't it? So here also we can see that the students of that class were trembling. Why? Because the forthcoming meeting, there was a meeting, and in that meeting the teachers are going to decide who will move up to the next form here means next class, and who will be kept back means fail or will not be promoted. Half the class is making bets. So they are making bets. Why? Oh, you will pass. No, I'm not going to pass. No, I'm sure you are going to pass. So this is how they are making the bets. Gian and I laugh ourselves silly at the two boys behind us. Gian is a friend. So Gian and I laugh ourselves. So they are finding it very funny when they heard the talkings from whom? The two friends who were sitting behind them. They were actually two boys sitting behind us behind them. They were Cian and Jax, who have staked their entire holiday savings on their bet. So they were putting on, they were saying that, okay, you will pass. No, I'm not going to pass. So they are putting bets, okay? And not only that, not simple bets. They were putting money for it. Okay, if what you say is correct, then this much money, I'll pay to you. So like that, they were putting bets. And you know, you also sometimes swear and put bets. Okay, 10 rupees bet if that happens. Like that you also do, isn't it? So same like that, their boys were also doing, particularly these two boys, Cian and Jax. They had staked their entire, they had saved lot of money during their holidays. So the whole money was put on that bet, deciding whether they will pass or not. From morning to night, it's like morning to night, it simply says that, okay, right from the day, starting of the day till the end of the day, this is the only thing which she can hear. What? You are going to pass? No, I am not. As you are? No, I am not. So this is what was happening on that particular day, because that was the particular day when they come to know whether they will be moving to the next class or will be kept back. I'm not. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. So these are the continuous things which can be heard in the class about the result. Even G's pleading glances and my angry outbursts can't calm them down. So what happened? So they made Anne and her friend was really tired of hearing such conversation. So what happened? G is a friend. She looked at these boys. Pleading means requesting, glances, looks, pleading or requesting looks, as to come on, stop it, it's enough, too much, it's really boring, it's headache, now come on, stop it. So that was that glance or that look meant, pleading glances, requesting looks, and my angry outburst means whose? Anne's angry outburst, bursting out in anger. Can't calm them down. Even the anger which she showed couldn't calm them down. If you ask me, there are so many dummies that about a quarter of the class should be kept back. So she's saying that if you ask me about my opinion, what I would say is, dummy, there are so many dummies. Dummies, here it actually means people of low intelligence. That means stupids. So dummies that about a quarter of the class, there were around quarter of the class who were considered as dummies and should be kept in that class itself. Whose opinion was that? Anne's opinion. What? That? It's not going, they are just dummies. Max quarter number of people were dummies in that class. But teachers are the most unpredictable creatures on earth. I'm sure you might be also thinking the same way about the teachers, isn't it? That teachers are the unpredictable creatures on earth. You do that, isn't it? You always say the teachers are moody. Sometimes they are angry, sometimes they are happy and all such things, isn't it? So the same opinion she had, what was it? Teachers are the most unpredictable. Unpredictable means which cannot be predicted or uncertain, unsure about their decisions, isn't it? So she completes the sentence by saying that teachers are the unpredictable creatures on earth. Now coming back to the next, she has a good opinion about her friends. So what's that? She says, I'm not so worried about my girlfriends and myself. She's not worried about myself or my friends, girlfriends in my class. We will make it. Make it means we will be promoted to the next class. The only subject I'm not sure about is maths. So maybe she did not like maths, or maybe she was weak in maths. And even though you are good in maths also, the only thing when the result comes you are afraid of is the mark which you are going to get in the subject maths. So same thing here also, she was also not sure about maths. Anyway, all we can do is wait. Until then, we keep telling each other not to lose heart. So is there anything which they can do? No. So what can be done? The only thing which can be done is to wait there, isn't it? And not only just to wait, but to keep, they kept telling each other what? Not to lose heart. Don't worry, everything will come out fine. So that's how they were just boosting up each other. I get along pretty well with all my teachers. She had a good rapport. We have already seen in the previous school, she had a good relation with the teachers, a good bond with the teachers, isn't it? So she's saying that I get along pretty well. Pretty well means I have a good relation with all my teachers. There are 9 of them. So how many teachers are there? 9. 7 men and 2 women. Mr. K. Singh, the old 4G who teaches maths. So who was teaching maths? Mr. K. Singh. And he was an old 4G. 4G means old fashioned, a conservative type of man. That means not very modern, who is very conservative, who teaches maths. And that was a person who was teaching maths. Was annoyed with me for ages. He was annoyed. Who was annoyed? Her maths teacher was annoyed, was angry to Annie because I talked so much. Why he was so annoyed? Because she was very talkative in the class. And of course, while teaching maths, if somebody talks, it's really disturbing. And Anne was one such that she was very talkative. She used to disturb the class and that used to annoy Mr. K. Singh. So, she knows the fact why Mr. K. Singh was annoyed, and she reveals the fact also, and that fact was what? She was very talkative. She used to talk very much in the class. After several warnings, she was every time she was warned not to talk. At last, what happened? He assigned me extra homework. So at last, he did what? To assign her homework. So he assigned her a extra homework other than the school work or the school maths. Something else was assigned to her. What was that? An essay on the subject, a chatterbox. So he is a maths teacher, but what assignment was given to her? Based on her nature. Her nature was what? She was very talkative. So based on that, she was given a topic to write. What was it? A chatterbox. And just imagine writing an essay on a chatterbox. It's really difficult, isn't it? A chatterbox, what can you write about that? So she's asking, she's thinking, what can we write about the topic of chatterbox? Is it very easy to write? We can't write an essay on easy topic, then think about writing an essay on chatterbox, isn't it? So she's also asking the same thing. What can you write about that? I had worry about that later. So she decided, okay, anyway, I have to write an essay. I will think about that later. I jotted down the title in my notebook. Jotted down means to write down the name of the source that she will not forget it. She wrote it down in the notebook, tucked it in my bag. Tucked it in means carried it in my bag and tried to keep quiet. So for the time being, she just decided to keep quiet. Nothing on based on that topic. She's not going to talk anything about it. She's going to keep quiet. Later on, that evening, after I had finished the rest of my homework, the note about the essay caught my eye. So later on, what happened? End of the day, when all the school work was over, she remembered this. She had written it down in the notebook, isn't it? So she started writing in the notebook. She remembered about the note which she has written in the notebook. And I began thinking about the subject while chewing the tip of my fountain pen. So nothing was, she has to write, isn't it? It was when you are given a homework, so you have to write it. You can't just avoid it, isn't it? So she started to think about it by chewing the tip of the fountain pen. She sat there and started to think about it. Anyone could ramble on and leave big spaces between the words. Anyone could ramble on means if you know the topic, you will be able to write many things about that topic. But suppose if you don't know anything about it, you really will find it difficult to write the topic, isn't it? So what did she think? Anyone could ramble and leave big spaces between the words, but the trick was to come up with convincing arguments to prove the necessity of talking. So you do that. Especially I have seen that in the junior classes in 8th and all, when they are asked to write the transcription. They will write 3 words in 1 line and finish it, isn't it? 3 words and 6 lines. So you will be able to finish the transcription fast, isn't it? Many of you have done it. So same thing she says, that you leave big spaces in between the words and then you can finish the essay, isn't it? But the point is, it should be convincing. Convincing means you should convince the person who is reading it by the sentences or by the points which you are writing. It should be convincing one. To prove the necessity of talking. To prove the necessity means you are talking through your essay. So that has to be proved that your argument is right. Whatever you are saying is right. You should be able to prove it. I thought and thought, and suddenly I had an idea. So what did, so without thinking, you won't be able to do it. So she started thinking. She went on thinking about it. I thought and thought, and at last she got an idea. I wrote 3 pages Mr. Keesing had assigned me and was satisfied. So what was the assigned topic? Chatterbox. And she wrote 3 pages on that particular topic and she was very much satisfied. I argued that talking is a student's trait and that I would do my best to keep it under control. So what was her point? Talking is a student's trait. Trait means a behavior, an attitude that has to be there, which is found in a student, and that I would do my best to keep it under control. The only thing which it's possible for me is to keep that trait under my control, but I can't stop this habit. So she says that the talkative nature is actually a trait of the students. So she says the only thing which can be done is she can bring it under the control. And also she says the fact what, but that I would never be able to cure myself of the habit, since my mother talked as much as I did, if not more, and that there's not much you can do about inherited traits. So she is saying a fact, what, I can't bring a cure, I can't cure myself from that nature. The only thing I can do is what, I can control it. Why? Because she's saying that this habit, talking habit, I got it from my mother. My mother talked as much as I did, if not more. She is also very talkative. She also talks just like me, if not more, like me she talks. And that's there, not much you can do about inherited traits. Inherited means something which you have received it from your parents. So she inherited this trait from her mother. So how can I bring a cure to that disease? Or maybe I can, how can I, it's not disease actually, how can I bring it a cure to that habit? So this is actually a habit which she inherited from her mother. So how can I bring a cure to that? Mr. Keesing had a good laugh at my argument. So when this essay was given to Mr. Keesing the next day, reading it, what happened? He had a good laugh at my arguments. Arguments mean the point which he has focused by giving importance to the word chatterbox. But when I proceeded to talk my way through the next lesson, so she was given the topic to write, she wrote it, and Mr. Keesing enjoyed that arguments. But did it bring any change in Anne? No. She says that I proceeded means I continued to talk my way through the next lesson. Even in the next period also, she continued with her talking. He assigned me a second essay. And what was the result? Next essay was given to her and assigned to her. This time it was supposed to be on. And what was the name of the essay given to her that particular time? An incorrigible chatterbox. Incorrigible. Incorrigible means that is impossible to be corrected. Of course, she said the fact that I can't change myself. I can't change my habit. It is a trait of a student to talk. I have inherited this trait from my parents or from my mother. So how can I bring a change in it? Isn't it? So that's why this time the topic of the essay was an incorrigible chatterbox. Chatterbox means one who talks a lot. I handed it in and Mr. Keesing had nothing to complain about for two whole lessons. So next day she wrote about the incorrigible chatterbox and she gave the assignment to Mr. Keesing and he had nothing to complain, nothing to speak about it. For two whole lessons, so two days, it was okay for her. She didn't have much problem regarding it. However, during the third lesson, he finally had enough. Anne Frank has punishment for talking in class. Write an essay entitled Quack Quack Quack, said Mistress Chatterbox. 2 days, it was okay. Third day, what happened? It was not possible to control himself. So he gave another topic. What was the topic? Quack, 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 said Mistress Chatterbox. So who is he referring to? Anne is the mistress here. And what was the topic? Quack, 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 Mistress Chatterbox. So that was the next essay assigned to her to write and give it to him. The class roared. Here, roared means to laugh loudly. Took the class roared. I had to laugh too. When Mr. Keesing and the whole class were laughing, could she control it? No, she also joined with them. Though I had nearly exhausted my ingenuity on the topic of the chatterboxes. Actually, she had lost all the ideas. No more ideas were left with her so that she can present it in the essay. So she says that nearly exhausted, tired of this behavior of writing this particular essay. Ingenuity means original, inventive ideas. She lagged now. All her ideas were over. So she was not able to write anything more. It was time to come up with something else. Now she understood that if she goes in the same way, it's not going to be. She understood that if this continues, she's not going to do anything. She has to change her idea of presenting it. So she started to think in that way. So she thought, now it's time to come up with something else. Something else means something new, something original. Original means which is real. My friend Sana, who's good at poetry, offered to help me write the essay from beginning to end in verse. So all this time she was writing in the essay form, isn't it? Her friend, she was very good at poetry. Sana. See, her name was Sana. So she said that she's going to help her write the essay from the beginning till the end, and that too in the verse form. Verse form means in the form of a poem. And I jumped for joy. So this idea, Anne was very happy with this idea, and she started to jump with excitement. Mr. Kesing was trying to play a joke on me with this ridiculous subject, but I had made sure the joke was on him. So now she had enough of this. So she decided, Mr. Kesing is making a joke of her by making her to write essay on this particular stupid, ridiculous means stupid topic. So it's time that now she makes a joke of him. So that's what she's saying. But I had made sure the joke was on him. So now if I write something, it should be something, a joke on him. I finished my poem and it was beautiful. So her friend helped her to write the story in the form of a poem, and she finished the poem and it was really beautiful. It was about a mother duck and a father swan with three baby ducklings who were bitten to death by the father because they quacked too much. So what happened? What was the content of her poem? It was about a mother duck and a father swan. They had three baby ducklings, but baby duckling means babies of the duck, baby ducklings, who were bitten to death. They were bitten to death by whom? By the father itself. Who is the father? Father swan. What did he do? He bit them. Why? Because they quacked too much. Quacked, just imagine, what can the duckling do other than the quacking? So they quacked too much, and which was swan, the father swan was not at all familiar with this quacking sound. So what happened? He bit them. Quacked means speaking. Here, the speaking, it means speaking, they spoke, but ducklings quack. So that's why quacked too much. Same thing. She was also punished. Why? Because she was talking too much. Here, father swan punished the ducklings. Why? Because they quacked too much. Luckily, Mr. Kesing took the joke the right way. She expected Mr. Kesing to be very serious with the poem, but luckily he took it in a very cool way. And what happened? He took it as a joke and he read the poem to the whole class. He read the poem to the whole class, adding his own comments. Not only that, he liked the poem so much that he read the poem to the whole class, and not only that, he included his own comments to that poem and to several other classes as well. Not only in her class, this poem was read in other classes also. He liked it so much that he took the poem and read it in other classes and enjoyed it. Since then, I have been allowed to talk and haven't been assigned any extra homework. So that was the last. So what happened? He never assigned her any extra homework, writing such type of ridiculous essays for her talking nature. And she continued with her habit. She was allowed to talk and she was not assigned with any of the extra homework. On the contrary, Mr. Kesing's always making jokes these days. On the contrary, the opposite to his behavior, what happened? He started to joke. He started to make joke along with the, during these days, he started to make jokes with his students. So with this, we come to the end of her diary, and that's what she is ending it with. Yours, Anne. Before we end, let me sum up what we have gone through this chapter. We have seen that Anne Frank, the introduction, we have seen how and who was Anne Frank. And she started to write the diary and her father published it. And initially she says that she was not willing to write the diary. She feels that it was a strange experience for her. And later on, she decides to write a diary as she doesn't have a true friend. So she starts considering her diary as a true friend, and she names her diary as Kitty. That's how she is addressing her diary. We have seen how she has addressed the diary. Then she gives a brief sketch about her life, That is the introduction of her life, about her parents, about her sister, and about her grandmother. What happened to her grandmother? She fell ill and she had to undergo the surgery. And later on, in 1942, her grandmother died. Then she comes to with the, she starts writing. This is the brief sketch about her life. She starts writing her diary on 20th June 1942. So she starts with the event of that day from the school. So that's the day when meeting is going to take place among the teachers to decide who is going to pass and who is going to fail. And that's how this particular excerpt is about the events that took place in her class. So she is basically a talkative girl, and her maths teacher is annoyed by this behavior, and that's how he gives her an assignment, an extra assignment of writing an essay. She was really worried about how to finish the essay, but she gets arguments, convincing arguments, by which her sir, Mr. K. Singh, was very much convinced. But she was with her nature of talking. And again, she got the punishment. And again, she was asked to write an essay on incorrigible chatterbox. You know that I told the meaning of incorrigible. Incorrigible means which cannot be corrected, difficult to correct. And later on, third time also, she gets to write an essay based on the topic quack, 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 mistress. And then mistress chatterbox. And then she also writes, her friend helps her to write a poem. And that poem really makes Mr. K. Singh very happy. And later on, you can see that Mr. K. Singh also adapts to the nature of making jokes. So this was what the summary about this chapter. With this, I conclude. Thank you.